Hello and welcome to another episode in the Godot Basics Tutorial Series. Godot Tutorials is not affiliated with or sponsored by Godot Game Engine. In this episode, we will be taking a look at HTTP Basics. HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. It is a format used to structure requests and responses over the internet. In a sense, HTTP works as a request and response protocol between a client and a server. The client, in most cases, is you and your computer. An HTTP request is data sent from the client to the server. In a sentence, you would say the server waits for a client request before responding. An HTTP response is data sent from a server to the client. When you send an HTTP request message, you will have to send it with a method. There are many methods provided to an HTTP request message. However, there are five common methods. They are the get method, post method, put method, patch method, and delete method. And their name implies what you are requesting from the server. Let's run through all the methods. The get method is used to retrieve a resource. This would be something like a web page. The post method is used to create a resource. Think of this as creating a username and password for a web application. The put method is used to update everything, and if that resource does not exist, create it. The patch method is used when you want to partially update an existing resource. And lastly, the delete method is used when you want to delete a resource. Let's take a deeper dive into each individual method. So again, the get method can be used to retrieve a resource. Let's say you want to access a web page. Well, your method would look something like this. You would have the method type. In this case, we want to use the get method because we just want to retrieve a web page. And then we follow that with the URL of the web page we wish to retrieve. In this case, we wish to retrieve a web page called godottutorials.com. Now, when we access godottutorials.com, we are returned back a web page resource, in this case, an HTML file. Now, when we receive that HTML file, we then request additional resource if our HTML file needs additional resource. This could include external CSS files, external JavaScript files, and so forth. Now, normally we would like to use our request methods with an API. An API stands for Application Programming Interface. So let's look at that example. So an API is a URL, and generally when you access this URL and combine it with a request method, you will expect a certain behavior based on your request method. So let me give you an example. In this URL provided to us, we need to access the somewhere slash API URL and provide it with the name of the table we wish to affect. And in this case, we wish to affect a table called persons. Now, normally APIs don't have to behave like this, but generally they do. And the reason it's set up like this is because when we provide an API URL with some type of request method, we expect a specific behavior to be applied to some resource. And in this case, that resource would be the persons table. Now over here, I have a table called persons. In this case over here, we have four different types of information: an identification number, first name, last name, and address. So let's take a look at how we would retrieve some type of information. In this case, it's a database with a table called persons, and see the behavior applied to the table based on our request method and our API URL. So in this case, with the get method, we wish to retrieve all data in the persons table. And so when we use the get method, we will get back all the information in this persons table, which would include the identification number, first name, last name, and address. Now let's look at how to create a resource. So in this case, we would like to add a resource onto the persons table. So we grab the API URL and we pass it information. Now the post method requires that you provide it all information that the table requires, in this case, a first name, last name, and address. And this would be the correct implementation for a post method, although it doesn't have to be followed to the letter T. Now let's go ahead and add a resource to the person's table. So in this case, we provided the information John Doe and Earth. And as you can see here, this information is applied directly into our person's table. Now, one thing to note is that the post method expects the server to create the identification number for you. And that's why our post method does not contain an ID number. So again, post method expects that the server creates the identification number for the client. And so in this case, we have a second row, first name John, last name Doe, address Earth, followed by an identification number of 2 created by the server. Now let's say we decide to use the post method again with the same exact information. Well, the server will create another identification number for that specific resource information you provide. And in this case, you can see here we have a third row with the same exact information. Now, in many cases, this is the type of behavior you expect the server to behave when you use the post method. However, if you don't want the server to keep on creating new identification numbers for the same exact information provided, you would use the put method. So the put method, unlike the post method, expects that the client provide it the identification number. So in this case, our API has persons/2, and we are saying that in the persons table, we would like to access the persons table with the specific row that has the identification number 2. And again, the put method requires that you give it all the information. So in this case, since the table requires a first name, last name, and address, it expects a first name, last name, and address. Again, even though I remove the person's row, this is still the person's table. Now, as you can see here in the table, we do not have an identification number 2. However, because we are using the put method will create the resource if the resource does not exist. And so in this case, when we pass it the first name, last name, and address, the server will either update an existing resource or create a new one if it does not exist. And because the resource did not exist, the server went ahead and created the resource for the person's table with an identification number 2, followed by the information John Doe and Earth. Let's go ahead and take a look what happens when we call the put method again. And so when we call the put method a second time, you'll notice that we haven't created a third row. And that's because the put method requires that you specify the specific resource in which you would like to affect. And in this case, because we have the /2, we're saying that we only want to affect the persons table with the identification number 2. And because the number 2 already exists, the information doesn't change, but the put method still goes through. It still updates everything, but because we gave it the information John Doe and Earth, it will replace all the information with John Doe and Earth. And because it's the same information, we change nothing. But the put method is still going through, affecting row number 2. Now let's say we want to change the information with the put method. Well, we keep the URL API the same. In this case, we wish to change persons with the ID number 2. And instead of John, we change the first name to Jack. However, because we're using the put method, we must provide it the values of everything in the table, which includes first name, last name, and address. Even though we do not want to change last name and address, we must still provide that information with the put method. And so in this case, when we pass this through to the API server, it will in fact change the first name of the person's table on row number 2. However, if you do not wish to provide all the information, you would use the patch method. The patch method expects only partial information. You do not have to provide all the information, just the specific information you wish to change on the resource. And in this case, with the patch method, we wish to revert back the changes we made with the put method. And so with the patch method, we just provide the first name being John, followed by the URL API in which we wish to change, in this case, the identification number 2. And as you'd expect, when we pass this to the API server, the information changes. One thing to note about the patch method is that it does not create a new resource if the resource does not exist. And that's because the patch method only expects partial information, whereas the post method and the put method requires all the information, and therefore the post method and the put method can go ahead and create an entire row without error because all the information is provided. So something to keep in mind. Post method creates a resource, but template expects that the server creates the identification number, the put method can create a resource if it does not exist and updates a resource but must be provided all information expected, and the patch method only requires the specific information you wish to change on the resource. However, the patch method cannot create a new resource. And lastly, we have the delete method, and in this case, we need to specify the specific resource in which we want to delete, and in this case, we wish to delete the persons with the identification number 2 with this specific API. And in this case, you can see down here that even though the resource exists, once we pass this method into the API server, that row gets deleted. And that's basically it for everything on request methods. Now moving on, we have HTTP response status codes. These status codes are given to us by the server. These status codes are useful for knowing what to do on the client side. Well, in order to determine what we do on the client side, we use status codes. So the first status code is information responses. These are numbers 100 through 199. The second type of response is successful responses, which are numbers 200 through 299. And these are the most common ones. When you access a web page and you are given back that web page, you are typically given a status code of 200. This lets the browser know that the server did what was expected of it, which was to give you a web page, and therefore your browser can now display it. The third type of status codes are redirect codes. And basically, redirect codes lets the, in this case, client know that it needs to go to a different URL address in most cases. And redirect codes are from 300 through 399. Redirects are useful when a web page has moved from one URL address to another. The next type of status codes are client error codes. Client error codes range from 400 through 499. And these codes let you know when it's the client's fault. For example, when the client does not have permission to access a resource, or if a client is trying to access a resource that does not exist. And lastly, we have server error status codes. And this lets the client know that the information is not being provided to the client because something is wrong on the server. And these server error codes range from 500 through 599. Again, status codes are useful when we need to do something on the client side. The next thing you should understand are HTTP headers. Now, headers let the client and the server pass additional information with an HTTP request or response. HTTP headers are a more advanced topic, however, let's go through them briefly. Now, headers come with a range of information. However, they can be categorized into 4 different types: general headers, request headers, response headers, and entity headers. General headers are used in both request and response messages. These can include cache control, connection, and date information. The next type of header is the request header, and request headers are used to provide information about the request being made. For example, host and user agent data, which is just your browser you are using along with the computer you are using, for example, Firefox and Macintosh, which is useful to the server to know what kind of information it needs to provide back to you. An example of an HTTP request header using the host and user agent, for example, is when you want to download a specific application for a specific computer. If you go into Google Chrome's main webpage and you click the download button, you can download it for Linux, Macintosh, or Windows. However, you send that information to the server, your computer type, and the server responds back with a download link to your specific computer. That's what a request header is useful for. On top of that, you can also send information like accept and accept language if you want to access different languages on the server if they provide them. And of course, the HTTP method in which you are requesting information for. The next type of header is the response header. The response header is used for the response context, basically the server context. The response headers can include the status code, which we went over previously. It can also provide you information such as content type. For example, is the information a HTML file or is it a JSON file? Also, the response header also includes cookies and cache. And of course, entity headers describes the payload of an HTTP request or response message, which includes again content length, content type, and expiration time. Well, that's all I have for you in this episode. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for clicking the like button, and thank you for clicking the subscribe button. I added a simple HTTP GET request GitHub project in the description down below, so please feel free to download that and just briefly see how you can make an HTTP request in Godot. In the next episode, we're going to take a look at HTTP request note. Thank you so much for joining me, and I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.